Hello, Boneyard. Welcome once again to another bone-snapping edition of the Boneyard. Grab your Bible, something to write with, something to write on. You're wanting to take notes as we're continuing our series in Ephesians. Be sure to open up your web browser, open up your application, something to follow along with us here at the Boneyard, because we here at the Boneyard believe in sola scriptura. No, that's not pig Latin, and it's not Spanish, and it's not some foreign language, but it is. It is Latin, and it means scripture and scripture alone. So we believe that God's thought is in print and it's right here, the Bible, and how we can apply this to our lives. So if you are a Christian, you believe that the Bible holds the highest authority in the Christian's life. We believe that God's word is spoken to us and we're under authority of the scriptures. Many of us like to believe that the Bible is like Play-Doh, like we get to mold it, sculpt it, and make it into anything we want. But we here at the Boneyard are under the authority of the Bible, not under the authority of a pope or a bishop or even our pastors. We're under the authority of scriptures. So we're going to start with a little hermeneutics, putting something in context. If you take scripture out of context, it's pretext, and that is error. So beginning here in Ephesians, Paul wrote to the church in Ephesus in the year 60 AD as he was under arrest for preaching the gospel. As he was in his prison cell, can you imagine him writing as the shackles on his wrist was weighing down his arms as he paid the price for preaching the gospel as he wrote to the church in Ephesus. So that's where the book of Ephesians comes from. Now, if you remember last episode, we didn't finish chapter 1, so we're going to pick up here in chapter 1, starting at verse 10, where Paul is talking about predestination, talking about the city that was on fire after preaching the gospel. Imagine in your city, what if the gospel was unadulterated preached? What if the gospel was preached? It would change the whole landscape of your whole community. The whole culture would change if the gospel was preached. Imagine preacher, or imagine pastor in your community, small groups leader, youth pastor, children's leader. If you preach the gospel, how will it change your church, your families, your homes? How will it change the political landscape of your nation if the gospel was preached? See, now it seems like pastors and preachers and people in authority and teachers of God have to bedazzle the cross. They put diamonds on it, throw some glitter on it, even put gimmicks and signs in front of them to make people attracted to the cross, but there's nothing attractive about a splintered field, rugged old cross, blood stained with the blood of Jesus. The only people that are attracted to those things are God's people. As we look to the cross, we're reminded of the price that was paid for our sins. So looking at Ephesians, as Paul was writing to the church, let's look in chapter 1, verse 10, as Paul continues his thoughts, and we'll lead right into chapter 2. So let us begin Ephesians chapter 1, verse 10, looking at as the plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. See, Christians, we have a blessed hope. We know that Jesus will return. See, if you like hearing the name Jesus, you have tuned in to the right show. See, there's many churches when they won't even mention his name. It's not politically correct to say the name Jesus because Jesus made astronomical claims. He claimed to be the only way to heaven. See, if Christianity was not so narrow-minded, if we had many ways to get to heaven, if we didn't claim that Jesus was the Son of God and the only way to get to heaven, oh man, we'll be on Oprah tomorrow. We'll be on Piers Morgan. We'll be all over. We'll be the latest fad because there are many roads. There are many roads. We hear that. But they all don't lead to heaven. They all lead to hell. There is one way to heaven, and that is through Jesus Christ, as he claimed to be the truth, the light, and the way. As we can see here that Jesus will return and unite all things under him in things in heaven and on earth. See, the Christian's soul, he has been redeemed. His spirit is being trained and renewed every day as we read in Romans chapter 12. But what about the body? Why do Christians get sick? Why do they have aches and pains? Why do they still struggle and limp through life? Our bodies are groaning as we read in Romans chapter 8 with utterings and words that cannot be expressed as the Spirit speaks for us. So why, if all things are going to be reunited unto Christ, why aren't our bodies transformed? Oh, but they will. See, this is one of the blessed hopes that the Christian believes. We believe that Jesus will return. Yes, our bodies are renewed and our hearts are changed and transformed and regenerated, but our bodies are waiting and longing, just like the earth is quaking and groaning like a woman in child pains and birth, as we wait for our Master, our God, our Shepherd to return to redeem our bodies. This is what many have called the snatching away, the parousia, the snatching and pulling away when Jesus returns on a cloud of glory and a cloud of great witnesses. This is what Paul is telling us here, as Jesus will reunite with his bride, his unblemished bride, the bride of Christ, which is the church. So we continue in verse 11. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things to the counsel of his will. Paul is getting deep in just this verse. We need to stop and slow down and marinate this verse. It says, in him we have attained. In who? In Jesus we have attained. We were orphans in sin, slaves to sin, but Jesus dying for sinners while we were yet sinners, he ransomed dirty, wicked people who were train wrecks, who were wretched people who deserved hell, and he lavished the mercy and grace on the Christian. As we gain an inheritance, notice if you're lost and you're going through the world and you're serving idols and other gods and not Jesus, your inheritance is death. Because the Bible teaches us, for the wages of sin, the cost, the price of sin is death. That is your inheritance. Listen, as you're watching, congregation, if you do not serve Jesus, those idols and those gods that you're worshiping, yes, you are worshiping something other than Jesus. If you're not serving Jesus, maybe it's yourself. Your inheritance is hell. Your inheritance is an eternity of getting exactly what you want. You don't want God. You don't want him. You don't want to serve him. So God gives you the desires of your heart. He puts you in a place where he is not there to comfort you, to cover you, protect you, and lavish mercy and grace. And that place is hell. But for the Christian, our inheritance is Jesus. Like God told Abraham in Genesis 15:1, he says, I am thy exceedingly great reward. See, Christian, we know that this world has a lot to offer. It has fame, fortune. It has all the promises of a good life. However, the greatest reward that a Christian can obtain and grab and hold on to is not riches, health, wealth. It's not any of those things. We know this is not our best life now. We know that God is the greatest reward. He is our inheritance. See, many people want heaven. They want the streets of gold, the gates of pearl, the mansions. They want to see their loved ones. They want to run through the city of Zion and worship. They want those things, but they hope when they get to heaven that Jesus is not there, that God is not on the throne. These are what they're hoping when they get to heaven, because they have to give an account for their lives. Many of us claim to be Christians by our confession, but by our life, we are practical atheists. We live as if God does not see us. We live as if God does not hold true what he says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13, where our lives are open and naked before God, that he sees our thoughts and our motivations of our heart. But for the Christian, our inheritance is God. We get to sit at the table, the banquet with the Lord of hosts. We get to sit at the feet of Jesus and throw our crowns and worship him. He is our exceedingly great reward. He is our inheritance. This is good news for the Christian. This is bad news for the rebellious and the religious. But the good news is Jesus redeems the rebellious and the religious, not for our sakes, not because we're good enough, or not because we're worth it, but because he is priceless and he is good, and it shows his goodness. That's where we get the Latin phrase, sola de gloria. This means God alone gets the glory. So as we stand in the judgment day before God, like it says in Hebrews 9:27, it's appointed for man once to die. We cannot boast. We only boast in the cross. We stand before God and say, it's not because of my good works, Lord. It's not because I'm good or I'm worth it. It's not because of my pedigree or my last name. It's not because of my position in my church. It's only because of Jesus that I am here. So sitting at the foot of Christ, we don't have any pride left in us. We're broken and know that it's because of his glory. It's because of him we're sitting at the foot of the cross and he saves wicked people. This is our inheritance. This is what Paul is teaching the Christian here in verse 11 of chapter 1. Let us continue as we lavish this good theology and study it and let it marinate over our soul. As Paul is teaching us, as Paul the Apostle is teaching us Christians, but how can we apply these things to our lives? By reading his word. Let us continue. Verse 12. Notice in verse 11, he says, who works all things according to the counsel of his will. Notice it doesn't say some things. It doesn't say sometimes or only the good things. All things to the counsel of his will. All things that God is sovereign. He's ruler over everything. Now, let's take a walk down logic lane. If you were God, you are sovereign. Sovereign means you rule over everything. Then, of course, there can't be any part of the universe or your creation that you do not rule over. Imagine if there was one neutron or proton, or if there's one living being or one eminent object that said that it was not under the rule of God and it rebelled against God and it was not under the rule of God, then God would cease to be a God. He would cease to be sovereign. So we know, using logic, that God is sovereign, ruler over everything. Does that mean the rebellious? Yes, he's king over the rebellious. He's ruler and God over all things. He's ruler of all principalities and high places. He is God. The earth is his footstool. He's mighty. He is creator. And as its creator, he has sovereign rights over everything. Many people hate that phrase, that Christians talk about a sovereign God who has rights over every part of creation. They hate that idea that they have to answer for God for their lifestyle because it's God who created them, has a right over their life. He created all things and he does according to his will. Who does God give counsel to? Who does he sit down and say, what do you think I should do? No one. We can read in Psalms 73, who do we have in heaven but you, O Lord? We can read in Job 38:39 that he creates the constellations, that he casts the stars into the sky, and he knows them by name. Who do we have but God? And he has sovereign authority over all of creation. Notice verse 12, so that we who are first, the hope in Christ, might be to the praise of his glory. Sitting at the foot of the cross, if we have nothing to boast about but only in Jesus, sola de gloria, and God alone gets the glory, as we praise him, the praise of his glory. Notice his people praise him because he saved them in spite of them. Look in verse 13. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit. We can read here that when called by God, like we can read in John chapter 6, verse 44, that when he is lifted up, he will draw all men into him, that the Holy Spirit draws you. But when he draws you, he seals you. He seals you. He places his stamp. Imagine back in the biblical times, or an emperor, or the ancient times, as they had a seal. This is something on their rings or something that they can use to imprint on an official document. We still use these today, even on our marriage certificates or paralegal, as they seal an imprint. They leave an imprint, a seal on a document. This is what the Holy Spirit does to the believer. As we read here what Paul says, we were sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit. We were imprinted with God. We were imprinted saying mine, but we're also sealed. That means to lock in. Imagine the influence of the world no longer affecting you, that you're not enamored by the glitter of this world, that you're sealed, locked in, mostly like a Ziploc bag, not letting air in or out, sealed by the Holy Spirit. Look in verse 14, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire the possession of it to praise of His glory? This is our down payment. This is God laying down the down payment for the believer, putting His Spirit in the believer. As we read in Ezekiel 36:26, that God will take out a heart of flesh, take out the heart of stone and put in a heart of flesh. He changes the heart. As we read in Ezekiel 37, that God takes the dead bones in the valley and breathes over them. The Spirit of God being the breath that enters into the dry bones, that this is the down payment, that is the inheritance. See, the believer understands what I'm talking about, because I'm speaking of spiritual things, of our inheritance, until we acquire possession of it to the praise of His glory. That the Spirit breathes on the believer. There are days where we just feel like we can't do anything, but there are days when we feel like we can jump over walls and we can accomplish great things. But we read in John 15, chapter 15, verse 5, outside of me, you can do nothing. The believer can't go around boasting that it's my faith that saved me. It's my focus or my tenacity or my zeal or my passion. No, outside of Jesus, we can't do anything. So Jesus is our source. He's the object of our faith. Notice, your faith doesn't save you. Your doctrine doesn't save you. Your denomination doesn't save you. It is Jesus that is saving you. He is our high priest. He is the one who is our shepherd. He is not a shofar. He's not a one driving us around, showing us. He's the one walking along us. He is the paraclete, the one, the Greek word uses the word paraclete, the one walking beside. He is our inheritance. He is the one who is our possession, our great, exceedingly wonderful reward. Look and continue in verse 15. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in Jesus Christ and your love towards all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remember you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the God of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of Him. Now, we just read a lot, so let's take it really slow. Notice Paul in verse 16 says, I do not cease to give thanks to you, remember you in my prayers. Does this mean that Paul constantly, every 5 minutes, would flip out a mat and fall to his knees in worship facing the east? No. Does this mean that Paul constantly prayed out loud, constantly, oh Father, I beseech thee by the mercies and grace that you have before? No. See, Paul walked in a lifestyle of mercy and prayer. He lived a life of prayer. Many of us say, I don't have time to pray. I can't pray like Paul prayed. I can't pray like my pastor prays. I can't even pray like my spouse prays. They're constantly praying. They're using these big words. They're saying, oh, mighty, omnipotent God, oh, and using 10-cent words. And they're just saying theological words that I don't understand. But Paul is telling us, using an example like he tells us in 1 Corinthians 1, 11:1, be like I am, be like I am. So we are to model the model that Paul was being like. We are to pray like Paul. But Paul lived a lifestyle of prayer. Whether he was working, whether you're whatever vocation you're in, that you can live a lifestyle of prayer, that you can lean upon grace and Jesus and lean upon the Word to be the best you can be at whatever you do. Whether you're a plumber sticking pipes together, whether you're a welder welding metal, whether you're a roofer, whether you're a stay-at-home mommy, whatever your vocation, you can live a lifestyle of worship and prayer, that you can lay hands on whatever you're working on and bless it in God's name, that you can do so unto the Lord whatever you do. This is what Paul was saying as he was an apostle. He's saying, I remember you in my prayers. See, whatever our churches are, whatever place and position you feel in your church, that you can do it with prayer. That is the greatest position, that our knees would get callous from prayer when coming before the throne of grace, boldly proclaiming to our God these requests, that He would hear the prayers of the righteous. As we continue, as in the verse 18, having the eyes of our hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope in which he has called you. What are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints? We have our eyes enlightened. As we read in Romans that this world has its eyes darkened by the God of this world, that many times they harden their own hearts. They see the truth. They logically see the truth that there is a creator. We can look at buildings and know there are an architect or a construction worker, but they deny that by looking at creation and saying there is no God. There's no divine creator. That's what their eyes are darkened. But we can see here that the Christian in verse 8:10, having eyes and your eyes enlightened. It is impossible to have science without God. It's impossible to have science without God. Con science, con with science knowledge, conscience. That's where we get that from. You notice Kevin's running down a lot of rabbit trails because this is thick theology and is logical. We know that God is creator of all things. We know that God is the Lord of all things. And having the eyes of our eyes enlightened, enlightened by the gospel, all the greatest scientific discoveries were given by godly men. As we can see here, knowing that you may know that what is the hope which is called you, that the riches of the glorious inheritance of the saints. Notice he talks about our inheritance once again. There's a rich inheritance for the Christian. Look in verse 19. And what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards those who believe, according to the working of his great might. Immeasurable greatness of his mighty power. What does it take to redeem a man? What does it take for one who has sinned against God? As Job talked about in chapter 9, how can a man be right before God? What does it take for a man to be blameless before God? It takes the blood of Jesus to be blameless, to be justified before God. This is the great power that Paul is teaching here. Look in verse 20. That he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places. If you go to Saudi Arabia and Medea, you will find the grave of Muhammad. If you go to Thailand and you go to seven spots, you'll find the ashes of Buddha. In many places, there are more than seven places with the ashes of Buddha there. All the great world religions. John Smith is buried in a family cemetery plot. All the great religions of the world, their founders' bones and ashes are still here on this earth. But Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. This proves that he is God. Looking in verse 21, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. That Jesus has authority over all names. His name's above every preacher's name. His name's over every bishop, over every political leader. He is Lord and God and sovereign of all. He's far above, exceedingly above all these things. As we continue in verse 22, and he put all things under his feet and gave him head over all things to the church. Now, there are many of us who are Lone Ranger Christians who have denied the church, who are saying the church is corrupt. I don't want anything to do with the church. I don't want to stay away from the church, but we have to love Christ. If you're a Christian, you love Christ. But you'll love the things that Christ loves. If you truly love Christ, Christ loves the church. He's the head over the church, just like a husband has an affection for his wife, a special affection, a holy affection, wanting to see his wife prosper, wanting to see his wife stronger, encouraging her, bathing her, and washing her in the word. Christ Jesus also has an affection for his church. Woe to those who keep attacking the church. There are those who are elect. There are those who are the elect, the calling, the remnant. There are those who are faithful to Jesus, and Jesus has a special affection for those that he has lordship over all the church, and all things are under his feet. Notice we read in Psalms where God speaks to Jesus. He says, come, let thy enemies be thy footstool. Notice that Jesus is ruler of all things. Sola Christus. Sola Christus. Jesus and Jesus alone. The Christian holds to that phrase. We don't believe in our works will get us to heaven. We don't believe that we're stuck in the rut of religion where we do this, do that, go to church on this day, do this, offer this, tithe that much, do this, go there, give away this. We don't believe that. We only believe and trust in what Jesus has done. It's not what we do. The Christian doesn't come to the cross and boast and say, I'm attributing this to my salvation. He doesn't believe in that. He believes in what Jesus has done in his salvation. The only thing you can attribute to your own salvation is the sin that Jesus died for. As the Christian comes with empty hands to the cross, we need empty hands at the cross so we can cling to the cross. We can dig our nails deep in the wood and let the blood of Jesus not cover our sins, but blot them out. Wash us and makes us clean as we let Jesus be sovereign over our lives. It's a point where you say, well, Jesus is God. He's sovereign and Lord. So at night we don't toss and turn and swim in our beds, but remember that Jesus is sovereign. He is our high priest. He is our God in whom we serve. You're saying, Kevin, I don't have faith. I don't believe what you're saying. How do I get this faith? How do I conjure up this zeal and this passion? How do I do this? The definition of faith is believing the truth. First, believe that the scriptures are God's words and believe what the scriptures say, that Jesus is the only way to heaven. Believe that Jesus died for your sins. Believe that Jesus washes away sin and makes you brand new, like it says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, that you're a new creature with new features. You're saying, Kevin, I'm too dirty to come to Jesus. I'm too nasty. I sin. If I were to walk into a church, it would burn down. If I were to go to church, the whole earth would shake. Jesus forgives sinners. God took your sin and put it on Jesus and had a bowl full of wrath that was meant for you, and he poured it out on Jesus on your behalf. So standing before God, you are justified. You are clean. You're just if I'd justified, just if I'd had never sinned. You stand before God holy and righteous, but you must believe the truth that Jesus died for sinners. You must repent of your sins and trust in Jesus. Repent of your sins and trust in Jesus. Repent of your sins and trust in Jesus.